knowledge about mental energy and its use. In the most basic sense, the purpose of life is being, as opposed to not being. In your system of three-dimensional reality, you are learning about mental energy, also called thought energy or psychic energy, and how to use it. Knowledge about mental energy and its use is learned by constantly transforming your thoughts and emotions into physical form, your physical reality, and by then perceiving and dealing with the matter and events that are formed. From doing this, you are supposed to get a clear picture of your inner development as it is reflected by the exterior environment. You participate in physical reality so that you can operate and experience within this dimension. Here, you can develop your abilities, learn, create, solve problems and help others. Matter is the shape that basic experience takes when it comes into your three-dimensional system. Your dreams, thoughts, expectations, beliefs and emotions are literally transformed into physical matter. How does this work? Every nerve and fiber within the body has an unseen inner purpose. Nerve impulses travel outward from the body, along invisible pathways, in much the same manner that they travel within the body. These pathways are carriers of telepathic thoughts, impulses, and desires containing all the codified data necessary for translating any thought or image into physical actuality, altering seemingly objective events. This telepathy operates constantly at an automatic or subconscious level, providing communication to back up sensory data. Telepathy is the glue that holds the physical universe in position, so that you can agree on the existence and properties of objects. In one respect, your body and all physical objects go flying out in all directions from the inner core of the whole self. The physical environment is, therefore, as much a part of you as your own body. What seems to be a perception, an objective concrete event independent from you, is instead the materialization of your own emotions, energy and mental environment. Events and objects are actually focal points where highly charged psychic impulses are transformed into something that can be physically perceived, a breakthrough into matter. The intensity of a thought or image largely determines the immediacy of the physical materialization. All such images or thoughts are not completely materialized, in your perception, as their intensity may be too weak. My intellect doesn't have the information to control all of this. How is it handled? There is an inner ego, an inner self which organizes unconscious material. As the outer ego manipulates within the physical environment, so the inner ego or self organizes and manipulates within inner reality. It is this inner self, out of massive knowledge and the unlimited scope of its consciousness, that forms the physical world and provides the stimuli to keep the outer ego at the job of awareness. The inner self organizes, initiates, projects and controls the transformation of psychic energy into matter and objects. It does not do to repress negative thoughts, such as fears, angers, or resentment. They should be recognized, faced and replaced. Recognize resentment when it is felt, and then realize that resentment can be dismissed. Initial recognition must be made. Then you must imagine removing the resentment by its roots and replacing it with a positive feeling. You must watch the pictures that you paint with your imagination. Your environment and the conditions of your life at any given time are the direct result of your own inner expectations. If you imagine dire circumstances, ill health or desperate loneliness, these will be automatically materialized, for these thoughts themselves bring about the conditions that will give them a reality in physical terms. If you would have good health, then you must imagine this as vividly as you fearfully imagine ill health. You create your own difficulties. This is true for each individual. The inner psychological state is projected outward, gaining physical reality, whatever the psychological state may be. The rules apply to everyone. Knowing this, you should try to realize what your psychological state is and change your conditions for your own benefit. You cannot escape your own attitudes, for they will form the nature of what you see. If changes are to occur, they must be mental and psychic changes. These will be reflected in your environment. Negative, distrustful, fearful, or degrading attitudes toward anyone work against the self. If an individual sees only evil and desolation in the physical world, it is because he is obsessed with evil and desolation and projects them outward, closing his eyes to other aspects of reality. If you want to know what you think of yourself, then ask yourself what you think of others and you will find the answer. True self-knowledge is indispensable for health and vitality. The recognition of the truth about the self simply means that you must first find out what you think about yourself subconsciously. If it is a good image, build upon it. If it is a poor one, recognize it as only the opinion you have held of yourself and not an absolute state. You are not your emotions. They flow through you, you feel them and then they disappear. When you try to hold them back, they build up. You are independent of your thoughts and emotions. You have emotions. You use your thoughts and emotions in your mental composition. You must learn to trust your own spontaneous nature. Your nervous system knows how to react. It reacts spontaneously when you allow it to. It is only when you try to deny your emotions that they become a problem. In spontaneity, there is a discipline that utterly escapes you, and an order beyond any that you know. Spontaneity knows its own order. All of nature is spontaneous. Our bodies will be healthy automatically if we do not project false ideas upon them. Action accepts all stimuli in an affirmative manner. This is why an illness is accepted by a personality structure, and once this occurs, a conflict develops. The self does not want to give up a portion of itself even while that portion may be painful or disadvantageous. Physical symptoms are communications from the inner self, indications that we are making mental errors of one kind or another. Do not forget that you are a part of the inner self. It is not using you. What you are supposed to do, then, is change your mental attitude, search yourself for the inner problem represented by the symptoms, and measure your progress as the symptoms subside. You sell yourself short if you believe that you are only a physical organism living within the boundaries cast upon you by time and space. You must accept life on its terms, and not demand that it behave in certain ways. You must accept life gladly, as its own reason and cause within you. Life is abundant, vigorous, and strong. Each of us has our own defense against negative suggestions and we should trust in our own immunity. You are a unique individual. You form your physical environment. You make and change your world. You are part of all that is. There is no place within you that creativity does not exist. You must live in faith that your purpose is, and will be fulfilled. The uniqueness of your own personality is to be cherished. The particular purpose of your present personality can only be met in the present circumstances in the way that is best overall. The people that you can help now and the particular good that you can do, can never be done in precisely the same way. Throughout the ages, some have recognized the fact that there is self-consciousness and purpose in dream and sleep states, and have maintained, even in waking life, the sense of continuity of the inner self. To such people, it is no longer possible to completely identify with the ego consciousness. They are too aware of themselves as more. When such knowledge is gained, the ego can accept it, for it finds to its surprise that is not less conscious, but more, and that its limitations are dissipated. What is the nature and purpose of dreams? A man's thoughts and dreams are more far-reaching than he knows. They exist in more dimensions, they affect worlds of which he is unaware. They are as concrete, in effect, as any building. They appear in many guises within many systems, and once created cannot be withdrawn. The dream world is constructed within a field that you cannot physically perceive, but it has more continuity than the world you know. The same sort of psychic agreement holds the dream system together as holds the physical system together. There is one self and it focuses its attention in various dimensions. In the waking state it focuses in physical reality. In the dream state it is focused within a different dimension. This does not mean that we do not sometimes leave our bodies and travel in our dream to other physical locations. When you are manipulating within physical reality, you have a fairly simple set of rules to serve you. Within dream reality there is greater freedom. The dreamer creates his dreams for his own purposes, selecting only those symbols which have meaning to him. Each dream begins with psychic energy which the individual transforms into a reality which is just as functional and real as physical reality. There is form within dream reality, but the potential form exists, within psychic energy, long before its materialization. Through our dreams we change physical reality, and our physical daily experience alters our dream experience. There is constant interaction. Our consciousness is simply directed in a different kind of reality when we dream, a reality as vivid as waking life. On one level, the personality attempts to solve problems through dream construction. And often this gives freedom to actions that cannot be expressed within the confines of waking life. Dream action can be turned toward fulfilling constructive expectations, which will effect a change for the better. Dreams can be utilized creatively to improve health, gain inspiration, restore vitality, solve problems, and enrich family relationships. You can have a pleasant and joyful dream that will completely restore your good spirits and vitality. In our dream life, we also visit other levels of existence and gain needed skills. The ego is not present in dream reality. The waking consciousness is not the ego. The ego is only that portion of waking consciousness that deals with physical manipulation. Waking consciousness can be taken into the dream state, but the ego cannot, as it would falter and cause failure there. When you take your consciousness into the dream state, you will meet with various conditions, some you can manipulate, some you cannot. Some dream locations will be of your own making, and others will be strange to you because they belong to other dimensions of reality. Individual consciousness can be sent through systems of reality. This involves the transfer of conscious energy from a home system to an alien one, and certain automatic changes are made from system to system, involving the use of brain waves, certain patterns being normal in different systems. As the personality is changed by any experience, it is changed by dreams. We may forget our dreams, but they are always part of us. The dream's experience is felt directly by the inner self. Dreams have their own actuality. They not only exist independent of the dreamer, but they also have tangible form, though not in the form of matter as you are familiar with it. They are forever contained as electrically coded data within the cells of the physical organism. The dream universe possesses concepts which will someday completely transform the physical world, but the denial of such concepts as possibilities delays their emergence. There are also shared or mass dreams. In these, mankind deals with problems of his political and social structure. In these, man dreams individually and collectively of ways in which changeabouts could occur. These dreams actually help bring about the resulting change. The very energy and direction of these dreams will help change the situation. The solutions reached are not always the same as those he accepts in the physical world. The energy behind a bad dream is the energy of hidden fears, which could be formed by anyone, since there are fears in anyone. Evil does not exist separate from the dreamer, and even illness or fear should not be seen as enemies, but rather as aids to understanding and means to a greater end. In larger terms, there is no evil, only your own lack of perception. Fear directs your conscious energy into the realm of reality of that fear, and you then must deal at that level. The words "may peace be with you" will get you through any difficulty in other layers of reality. Identity, personality, ego, and their multidimensional aspects. Consciousness is not a thing in itself, rather, it is a dimension of action made possible by a series of creative dilemmas. There are three dilemmas which represent the areas of reality within which the inner vitality of the universe can express and experience itself. The first dilemma is inner vitality's desire and impetus to completely materialize itself, and its inability to do so. This results in action, which is a part of all structure. Identity may be termed as action which is conscious of itself. An identity is also a dimension of existence, action within action, an unfolding of action upon itself, and through this interweaving of action with itself, through this reaction, an identity is formed. Identity and action cannot be separated. Without identity, action would be meaningless, for there would be nothing upon which action could act. Action then must, by its very nature, create identities. Identity, because of its characteristics, will continually seek stability, while stability is impossible. Action would seem to destroy identity, since action must involve change, and any change seems to threaten identity. However, identities are never constant, for consciousness without action would cease to be conscious. Identity must seek stability while action must seek change, yet identity could not exist without change, for it is the result of action and a part of it. This is the second dilemma. Identity is not the same as individual personality. Personality represents only those aspects of identity which are able to be actualized within three-dimensional existence. The ego at any given time in this life is simply the part of the inner self that surfaces in physical reality, a group of characteristics that the inner self uses to solve various problems. Even the ego as we think of it changes constantly. Ego consciousness is a state resulting from the third creative dilemma, which happens when consciousness of self attempts to separate itself from action. This involves a state in which consciousness of self attempts to perceive action as an object, and to perceive action, which is initiated by the ego, as a result rather than as a part of ego's own existence. This is impossible since no consciousness or identity can exist without action. Each of you exists in other realities and other dimensions, and the self that you call yourself is but a small portion of your entire identity. Within the self that you know is the prime identity, the whole self. This whole self has lived many lives and adopted many personalities. Personality may be somewhat molded by the circumstances that are created for it by the whole self, but the prime identity uses the resulting experience. Personality and identity are not dependent upon physical form. Your prime identity is an energy essence personality which is composed of energy gestalts. As each individual consciousness grows, out of its experience it forms other personalities or fragments of itself. These fragments are entirely independent as to action and decision, while constantly in communication with the whole self of which they are a part. These fragments themselves grow, develop, and may form their own entities or personality gestalts. You have constant contact with the other parts of your whole self, but your ego is so focused upon physical reality and survival within it that you do not hear the inner voices. No individuality is ever lost. It is always in existence. Consciousness is the direction in which the self focuses. Action implies infinite possibilities of focus. What you call death is rather your choice to focus in other dimensions and realities. You do not acquire a spirit at death. You are one, now. You adopt a body as a space traveler wears a space suit, and for much the same reason. Each individual from birth forms his own counterpart from built-up, individual, continuous electrical signals that include his dreams, thought, desires and experiences. This counterpart of complete experience is a pattern which is then independent of physical reality. At physical death his personality then exists detached from its physical form. Probable systems of reality. For its own purpose, and because of its limitations, the ego chooses a single event from all the probable ones. Until the ego experiences the event it is only one of all the other probable ones. It becomes actual in your reality only when it is experienced by the physical self. A portion of the whole self can and does experience events in an entirely different fashion than the ego does and is aware of all other probable events that could have been experienced by the ego. This other portion of the self delves into these alternative events in the same amount of physical time that it takes the ego to experience its chosen event. These other probable events become just as real within other dimensions. There are an infinite number of systems or universes between matter and antimatter. Using the physical senses you can never perceive these other systems, but probable events are events whether or not you perceive them. In dreams, Often portions of probable events are experienced in a semi-conscious manner. Advanced training in the use of the inner senses can also lead to exploration of these systems. These systems of probabilities are quite as real as your physical system, you are simply not focused within them. In these other systems of reality, each of us has other selves, not an identical self or twin, but other parts of our whole entity, developing abilities in a different way than we are here. Each of these selves experiences time in its own manner according to the nature of its perceptions. Their various realities merge in the overall perceptions of the whole self. There is a constant subconscious interchange of information between all these layers of the whole self. Ultimately, the inner ego tries to bring about comprehension by each of these selves about the other simultaneous selves. Until the whole self is able to perceive its own parts simultaneously, these seemingly separate selves appear, to themselves, isolated and alone. What is the nature of time? Time as you experience it is an illusion caused by your own physical senses. They force you to perceive action in certain terms, but this is not the nature of action. The apparent boundaries between past, present and future are only illusions caused by the amount of action you can physically perceive, and so it seems to you that one moment exists and is gone forever, and the next moment comes and like the one before also disappears. Everything in the universe exists at one time simultaneously. The first words ever spoken still ring through the universe, and in your terms, the last words ever spoken have already been said. The past, present and future only appear to those who exist within three-dimensional reality. The past exists as a series of electromagnetic connections held in the physical brain and in the non-physical mind. These electromagnetic connections can be changed. The future consists of a series of electromagnetic connections in the mind and brain also. In other words, the past and present are real to the same extent. You take it for granted that present action can change the future, but present actions can also change the past. The past is no more objective or independent from the perceiver than is the present. The electromagnetic connections were largely made by the individual perceiver. The connection can be changed, and such changes are far from uncommon. These changes happen spontaneously on a subconscious basis. The past is seldom what you remember it to be, for you have already rearranged it from the instant of any given event. The past is being constantly recreated by each individual as attitudes and associations change. This is an actual recreation, not a symbolic one. The child is indeed still within the man, but he is not the child that was, for even the child within the man constantly changes. Difficulties arise when such alterations do not occur automatically. Severe neurosis is often caused precisely because an individual has not changed his past. A change of attitude, a new association, or any of innumerable other actions will automatically set up new electromagnetic connections and break others. Every action changes every other action. Therefore, every action in your present affects actions you call past. It is possible to react in the past to an event that has not occurred, and to be influenced by your own future. It is also possible for an individual to react in the past to an event in the future, which in your terms, may never occur. Because past, present and future exist simultaneously, there is no reason why you cannot react to an event whether or not it happens to fall within the small field of reality in which you usually observe and participate. On a subconscious level, you react to many events that have not yet occurred as far as your ego's awareness is concerned. Such reactions are carefully screened out and not admitted to consciousness. The ego finds such instances distracting and annoying, and when forced to admit their validity, will resort to the most far-fetched rationalizations to explain them. No event is predestined. Any given event can be changed not only before and during but after its occurrence. The individual is hardly at the mercy of past events, for he changes them constantly. He is hardly at the mercy of future events, for he changes these not only before but after their happening. An individual's future actions are not dependent upon a concrete finished past, for such a past never existed. The past is as real as the future, no more or less. There is a part of you that is not locked within physical reality, and that part of you knows that there is only an eternal now. The part of you that knows is the whole self, your inner and outer ego, all that you are. Greater than from within this framework you will see that physical time is as dreamlike as you once thought inner time was. You will discover your whole self, peeping inward and outward at the same time, and find that all time is one time, and all divisions, illusions. Seth, now, I propose for each of you an experiment. You must each do it for yourselves, and it is a tricky one. Perhaps one of the trickiest, in many ways, that I can devise. You must understand, however, the basis for the experiment that I am proposing. You must realize, first of all, that your private reality is one of numberless probable realities. You are experiencing one of many probable realities. Now, because of your neurological structure, you can only physically perceive, in your terms, so many events at once. Therefore, from an unlimited number of probable events, you choose those which you will perceive through your physical system, in terms of time and biological reality. It seems to you as I speak, however, that the reality that you know is rock-bed reality and that all other realities are probable. Instead, you are perceiving and experiencing one of many probable realities for yourselves. You must understand that or the experiment will not work. If you insist on thinking of your present reality as rock-bed reality, and everything else as probable, then the experiment will not work. So, first of all, you must realize that you are experiencing one probable reality of many. Now take, each of you, an area of your life with which you are not pleased in your terms. Think of it. Now, do not think of it in terms of rock-bed reality, but as one of many probable realities that you have brought into your experience because of your beliefs. Now, hold in your mind the idea that there are other probable realities in that one area that you can just as easily pull into your physical experience, and experience this biologically, practically, and intimately in your daily life. Then, for perhaps 5 minutes a day and no more, imagine yourself through your beliefs pulling that portion of probable reality into your own. For that amount of time you must, however, change your belief in that area. You must realize that your belief pulls the reality to you, and therefore only, now, for 5 minutes, change the belief. And if you do this faithfully, you will find your reality in that area changing. Why only 5 minutes? Because if you do this any longer, you will hassle it.